So we'll make a start. O God, the Son, highest and holiest, who humbled yourself to share our birth and our death, bring us with the shepherds and the Magi to kneel before your holy cradle, that we may come to sing with your angels your glorious praises in heaven. Where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, God, world without end. Amen. I'll light our candle. It's a very calm morning out there today, isn't it? Since I dyed my hair this colour, I seem to have unintentionally matched my wardrobe, because it's funny what lockdown does to you. Lord, by the song of the angels, you disclosed your birth to your own people, and by the leading of a star, you revealed your glory to strangers. Teach us to know you now, and to make known to all. Amen. Come on, Laura. Laura, I don't know if you can help me. Do we have a psalm for this morning, or is it just the reading? Don't worry if not. We'll begin with our reading today, which is Mark 14, 12 to 21. Just the beginnings of preparing for the Last Supper. Awful, thank you so much. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when it is customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house, he enters, the teacher asks, 'Where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us in there." The disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived at the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They were saddened, and one by one they asked him, "Surely you don't mean me?" "It is one of the 12. he replied, "one who dips his bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go as it has been written about him. But woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him not to be born. Good morning, Alan. Good morning, Kath. So I'll just read that again. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house that he enters, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room, where I eat my Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there.' The disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When the evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, 'Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.' They were saddened, and one by one they said to him, 'Surely you don't mean me.' 'It is one of the 12, he replied, one who dips his bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him, but woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him not to be born." So thank you, Yvonne, for helping me out there. So the psalm, Psalm 144. Praise be to the Lord, my rock, who trains my hand for war, my fingers for battle. He is my loving God and my fortress, my stronghold and my deliverer, my shield in whom I take refuge, who subdues peoples under me. Lord, what are human beings that you care for them? Mere mortals, that you think of them. They are like a breath. Their days are like a fleeting shadow. Part your heavens, Lord, and come down. Touch the mountains, so that they smoke. Send forth lightning and scatter the enemy. Shoot your arrows and rout them. Reach down for your hand from on high. Deliver me and rescue me from the mighty waters, from the hands of foreigners, whose mouths are full of lies, whose right hands are deceitful. I will sing a new song to you, my God, on the 10-string lyre. On the 10-string lyre, I will make the music for you, make music to you. To the one who gives victory to kings, who delivers his servant David, from the deadly sword, deliver me. Rescue me from the hands of foreigners, whose mouths are full of lies, whose right hands are deceitful. Then our sons in their youth will be like well-nurtured plants, and our daughters will be like pillars, carved to adorn a place. Our barns will be filled, and with every kind of provision. Our sheep will increase by thousands, by tens of thousands in our fields. The oxen will draw heavy loads. There will be no breaching of walls, no going into captivity, no cry of distress in our streets. Blessed is the people of whom this is true. Blessed is the people whose God is the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. So, does anyone have any thoughts or reflections about anything I've just read? Preparing to be betrayed. Preparing for the Passover lamb, and then Jesus saying he's going to be betrayed, and he is the lamb. I can't quite believe we're almost done with. Okay, so shall we move into a time of our intercession prayers? As always, when we pray, feel free to write in the comments so we can pray for one another. Sorry. Did Jesus predict the man with the jar of water out there? That is a question, isn't it? Did he predict the man with the jar of water having everything prepared for him? Or did he do the admin beforehand and then just... Sorry, I think there's a slight delay in comments coming through, so yeah, that is a point, the prediction that someone was going to prepare the upper room for him, or was it? Pre-prepared. Does anyone else have an opinion on that? That is quite interesting. I wouldn't know. That doesn't say. Could very well be in a prediction. the fact that the owner of the house knew exactly where to go, where to direct the disciples. Sorry, Yvonne, I'm just going to have to press this to read your comment. There we go. Tree Gospel of War. Yeah. Keep focus. Yeah, I think there might be a story behind that. There might be a yes. With the cults tied up and things like that, though, with it being a sort of like a preparation of a hotel. That sounds a bit more like he's arranged it beforehand. So forgive me, I'm just going to get another cup. Yeah, so with it being another prediction, it would feed into kind of that's the way Jesus works, but with the hotel it just sounds like he's it's not as, you know, miraculous for him to know if he's. It sounds like he's made the booking. Yeah, the opportunity to sort of stand up for themselves, isn't it? It's like when if you're in a situation and you get accused of something and it is automatically like trying to prove your innocence. I'm just looking at like menial matters, nothing serious, but the opportunity to change the mind, to know that he's aware that what they're going to do, and the disbelief like amongst the group as well. Just gonna have to move this again, give you a lovely view of my chins. Yes, Jesus' story could have ended up like Peter's and not as tragic. Still tragic, but yeah, that's that thing about choice, isn't it? He could have chose to say that. So we'll move into our time of intercession prayer. As always on a Friday in particular, we pray for our student communities. Feel free to type in the comments and pray for one another. Just make a start. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather online and hear your word, Lord, for the community and for the friendships that have developed, that we're able to hold this time daily throughout the week. As we come to the end of Epiphany and celebrate Candlemas and going into the season of Lent, we ask for your blessing. Thank you for this week, Lord, we pray, particularly for our parish, our team, our lay and ordained members of staff that work hard behind the scenes. And we pray for our student communities, Lord, throughout Liverpool and the three universities. For the students who are at home right now, who aren't coming back to Liverpool. For the wellbeing outreach for them to continue their studies. Particularly for the international students who may feel very lonely at this time. Maybe feeling particularly isolated. Thank you for the sector ministers meeting this week, where different chaplains from different institutions gathered together and prayed for one another and shared their problems and their difficulties and their joys. And offer that peer support. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the work and the food banks and all that is still going on physically at St. Bride's. We pray for the garden and the gardening opportunities for young people, in particular at St. Michael in the City. And we pray for that to be taken up as an opportunity. And we pray for Tim and his family. And the offer of a house. And all that anxiety that comes with that. Pray for patience and guidance. Yeah. We pray for our students who are redoing their studies. Postponing their studies, deferring their studies to the new academic year for various different reasons. Pray particularly for lecturers and support staff who are working so hard. And pray for our teachers in schools who not only have been designing and delivering lessons, but they've been in positions of delivering food parcels to families as well. And all of the decisions involved with that. Mm-hmm. Yes. pray for those who have lost their jobs in recent announcements of retail businesses like Debenhams in particular, the bars and the clubs that are shutting down, the local venues, the small venues, which are going to affect so many, and a huge population of the student communities that are taking up part-time work along with their studies, and then maybe they don't have a job to come back to. And hospitality and retail. I pray for wisdom for Helen, using that time, not doing your usual job, and that creativity and planning and flexibility and what the role looks like. And pray for that resilience for students. Some students I spoke to last night, so resilient and just sort of taking it as it comes. It's amazing. And just pray that that continues, that resilience and that self-drive, but also knowing where they can go to get the well-being support. Limited interaction with others, yes. Those friendships that are forming maybe only on an online basis. The students who have started uni and maybe have only been on campus a handful of times or for a couple of weeks. It must be so such a bizarre experience. We pray for their strength and their hopefulness and their courage to continue their studies, given it's just so strange this year. Pray for the staff at the nursery, one positive case. Never ending. Oh, that's brilliant news. Yeah, and then we pray for the those responsible for the vaccine, those people getting trained to administer the vaccine, the research that's gone into it, and all of those working around the clock. Get it out to vulnerable people. Those decisions made into the careers, and those who have maybe had to change their career path over lockdown. I know quite a lot of artists who have had to take up new training, new skill sets. Those studying who may be feeling uncertain whether there's going to be a job at the end for them in the subject that might. Particularly the creative subjects. And we pray for Beth and her family at this time, for that connection, for their continued health and strength through their grief. We pray also for connections that I made this week with one of the LGBT societies, for their enthusiasm and curiosity about Open Table, for the questions and welcome they made me. We pray for those conversations to be fruitful, and maybe we'll have a few more students who would like to join us at Open Table, which I think is marvellous. Pray for Reverend Mark, so we could from surgery. So we bring our prayers to you, Lord, spoken and unspoken, those typed in the comments, everything on our hearts, and join in the Lord's Prayer, in whatever version you feel most comfortable, in whatever language you feel most comfortable, we join together. And we have the New Zealand version. Divine Mother, Divine Father, to be in you is to be in heaven. May we hear the wonder that echoes in your name. May we accept no rule but the rule of love. May we never tolerate the evil of hunger. May the hurts we cause be forgiven. And the hurts that we receive be healed. May we remember that we are fragile, and cherish the life we shape with all, we share with all. For all love and life and power is the gift of your spirit. Amen. May God the Father, who led the wise men by the shining of the star, to find the Christ, the light from light. Lead us in our pilgrimage to find the light. May God the Son, who turned water into wine at the wedding feast, transform our lives and make glad our hearts. May God the Holy Spirit, who alighted on Jesus at his baptism in the River Jordan, Pour out her gifts on us, who have come to the waters of new birth. Amen. Jesus Christ, the beginning and the end, hold us as we end one year and begin another. Hold us within the circle of your unending love. In the circle of God's love, we are one. The circle is never broken. In the light of God's welcome, we are one. The light never goes out. Let children teach us the wisdom of play. Let neighbours teach us the gentleness of care. May the circle surround us when we are apart. May the light draw us together again. Amen. Thank you everyone for joining in morning prayer. What have we got on today? At 12 PM I'm going to be doing some more intercessionary prayers for our student communities, and that is over on the Chaplaincy to the University's Facebook page. So we do that every week between myself and the Methodist chaplain. So that's at 12, and if anyone's interested in joining, praying with us, that'd be great. And I'll see some of you on Sunday. Thank you. Thanks, Alan. Thanks, Kath. Thanks, Laura. Speak to you later, Laura. Bye.